Okay, hello everyone. My name is Casey Altiero and I'm Chief External Affairs Officer at the Joyce Foundation. Thank you for joining this discussion hosted by the Joyce Foundation and Bridge Michigan. Today we will explore the growth of armed extremists and militias in Michigan and across the country and the potential implications of this activity on our democratic institutions. Before we get started, a few housekeeping items. First, today's webinar is being recorded and in the coming days will be made available on the Joyce Foundation and Bridge Michigan websites. And after the discussion, we will be sure to share any key materials referenced. The discussion will last 1 hour with the final 20 minutes reserved for your questions. And to that end, if you have a question for today's speakers, please include it in the Q&A feature found at the bottom of your screen. I would encourage you to submit your questions as you think of them, even before we get to the Q&A, so that we can try to answer as many as possible. Okay, with that, let's get to it. From headline events like the January 6th attack on the US Capitol nationally, to the attempted kidnapping plot of Michigan Governor Gretchen Whitmer locally, the issue of violent political extremism, when groups use violence and intimidation to influence policy and disrupt government, is a new phenomenon to many. But for those like our speakers who have observed extremist and militia movements over time, recent events like these in the April 2020 armed protests at the Michigan State Capitol have been years in the making. And given the current political environment, this dynamic shows no signs of abating and might even be on the brink of worsening. To discuss these trends, their implications on democracy and government institutions in Michigan, and what policymakers might be poised to do about it, I am delighted to introduce our two guests for today. Jonathan Oosting is a state government and politics reporter for Bridge Michigan. He spent significant time reporting on political and militia extremism in 2021 with grant support from the Fund for Investigative Journalism. For that work, along with his continued reporting on the fallout from claims about the 2020 presidential election, Jonathan was recently named the Richard Milliman Journalist of the Year by the Michigan Press Association. For those less familiar with Bridge Michigan, it's a nonprofit, nonpartisan news organization that provides passionate and rooted Michigan readers with honest, fact-based journalism on the state's diverse people, politics, and economy. And you can read every day at bridgemi.com. Thank you, Jonathan, for joining us today. We also have with us Heath Druzin, who is the creator and host of the new podcast, Extremely American. For the podcast, Druzin spent more than a year taking an inside look at militias and other far-right groups to report about their influence on American politics. Since 2018, Heath has covered extremism, politics, and gun issues for outlets such as NPR, the BBC, the Daily Beast, and post-industrial media. Previously, Heath covered the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan and veterans issues for Stars and Stripes newspaper, and is currently based in Boise, Idaho. Thanks, Heath, for joining us as well.
Thanks for having me.
Okay, looking forward to this. All right, so first up, why don't we do a little scene setting for our audience and talk about the current state of violent political extremism in Michigan. And Jonathan, let's start with you.
Yeah, so, obviously the recent trial involving alleged kidnap plotters against Governor Gretchen Whitmer sort of thrust this issue into the national spotlight. But, that, as you mentioned in your introduction, seemed perhaps a long time coming. It is important to note that two of the four suspects in the federal trial were in fact found not guilty of participating in a conspiracy to kidnap Governor Whitmer, but two of the other defendants, the ringleaders really, there was a mistrial there and they could be prosecuted a second time. Some of these same individuals were at, for instance, the April 30 armed protest at the Michigan Capitol that you mentioned. Michigan has a long history of militia movements, some of them quite peaceful. Some of them, really legitimately focused on training exercises, but some of them not. And I think in 2020 and 2021, especially, we saw tensions really rise and escalate because of the COVID-19 pandemic and some of the resulting policies that were put in place by Governor Whitmer. And some people who perhaps had been living in the shadows were emboldened to come out into the public with their guns and speak loudly and at times perhaps according to prosecutors cross lines here. There's also been some other extremist cells, white supremacy activity in the state, and again the state has a long history of militia activity, so sometimes this stuff has not necessarily raised a lot of eyebrows until folks emerge into public. I followed a cell in Bad Axe, Michigan from a group called The Base, and they operated kind of quietly there for quite some time. And it wasn't until some of the members attended a Black Lives Matter protest to counter protest that the community really took notice. So I don't think we've seen a lot of I think what we saw in the last couple of years was sort of a natural evolution of things that have been building here in Michigan for quite some time.
Heath, before you jump in, I just wanted to sort of unpack a little bit something that Jonathan said about sort of previously militias being somewhat peaceful and doing legitimate exercises. Can you just sort of tease out a little bit like the distinction that you're drawing between sort of the militias of old and what you're seeing today? That was for you, Jonathan, I'm sorry.
Oh, sorry about that. Certainly, there have been examples of clandestine or potentially illegal behavior by militias here as well. There was the Hutari sect that was prosecuted several years ago unsuccessfully as well. The Oklahoma City bombers had connections to Michigan militia movements. So there's been some bad apples certainly here, but militias have continued to operate in the state, on a pretty regular basis for the last several decades. And, there haven't been a huge amount of it, public incidences anyways, where these groups have come to the forefront. Again, I think the pandemic really emboldened people. I think these militia groups really saw outrage over the pandemic as an attempt or as an opportunity to recruit. And the people they were recruiting were perhaps more radicalized and more angry, really, is what was driving it, as opposed to just some desire to, train for weapons usage and things like that, that these groups, claim as their primary purpose.
Hmm. Heath, are you seeing some of the same dynamics?
Yeah, yes. I mean, what Jonathan said, really squares with what I've seen, not only in Michigan, but around the country. I'm obviously based in Idaho, where there's a pretty robust militia movement as well, and a big history of that. And, what's interesting about what Jonathan said is, I think, a really important point about day in and day out, a lot of these groups are out in the woods, the mountains, what have you, doing weapons training, and, legitimately sort of out there training without a particular violent motivation in mind. Although with the caveat that almost all of them will say, if the government, becomes, as they say, tyrannical, then we will fight them. So wherever that line is, I think, there's a big question there. But I think where things really get a little scary is that whatever the motivations of the majority of these groups and their leaders, which I would say generally is not directly, getting ready for violence, there are a lot of people, there are a fair number of people out there who want to see action, and they aren't content with these groups training for some sort of theoretical eventuality. And that's where things not only get scary, but I think get very hard to control, because you do have people who get radicalized. And Jonathan mentioned Oklahoma City. And I know the Michigan members of militias in Michigan hate when this is brought up because they think it's unfair. But the fact is that the bombers attended at least one meeting of the Michigan militia, and they were certainly inspired by anti-government ideas. So that's, and they're the most sort of egregious example and the deadliest example, but they're by far not alone. You certainly have examples across the country of people going to things like the ranch standoffs that the Bundy family had. That's when the government tried to get cattle from a Nevada rancher, and a bunch of militia members descended on the ranch and pointed weapons at federal agents. Well, one of the guys who went to that ranch, he and his wife went on to kill several people in Las Vegas, including a police officer, and then died in a hail of bullets. Now, what responsibility do the Bundys play for that, or, you know, other people who were there for inspiring them? That's an open question. But the point is that these ideas can very easily be taken the next step to with people who might be more radicalized to actually, you know, take violent action. And there's very little command and control in these groups. You know, I think our listeners won't be surprised to hear that people with anti-government views aren't very good at central control. You know, they want to be individuals. Well, with that comes a lack of control of some of their members who might want to take things farther than their leadership wants.
Exactly. So I wanted to pick up on sort of a thread you both kind of put out there in terms of the history of the militia movement in Michigan and some prior violent eruptions. From you said Oklahoma City bombing. Jonathan mentioned the storming of the Capitol in April 2020. How did that, because that event was very shocking to a lot of people looking from afar. Can you talk about sort of the particular events that led to that? And so just what happened there?
Yeah, I can speak to that a little bit. That was actually, you know, there had been several protests already at the Michigan Capitol, protesting Governor Whitmer's pandemic orders. This one came on a day that the Michigan legislature, the Republican-led legislature, was considering whether to extend an emergency declaration that gave Whitmer some unique powers to, you know, issue executive orders. Now, they didn't end up doing that, and Whitmer still found other powers to use to continue to issue those executive orders. But activists saw it as a real sort of, you know, point where they wanted to draw a line in the sand and legitimately pressure the legislature not to extend this emergency declaration. Now, some of the organizers, one of the organizers, Ryan Kelly, who's now running for governor of Michigan as a Republican, he has said expressly that he invited militia groups to that rally to provide, quote unquote, security, you know, to essentially act as, you know, vigilantes if the opportunity arose. Several other folks who were not part of that security detail would show up with long guns as well. Adam Fox, who had a mistrial in the Whitmer kidnapping plot and could face prosecution again. He was one of them. He was there wearing, in fact, full Boogaloo attire, you know, the Hawaiian shirt. And we should note that the Boogaloo movement is sort of a new, you know, wrinkle in these militia groups. It's not necessarily directly related, but the Boogaloo adherents, you know, ostensibly believe that there is, you know, society is about to collapse and there's going to be a war for survival and they're preparing for it. So anyways, all of these elements sort of came to a head at the Michigan Capitol on that same day where you had a lot of angry people, a lot of people with guns. You know, they didn't so much storm the Capitol. I've heard it described that way. I mean, the Michigan Capitol is open to the public. They were allowed in, but they did then congregate right outside the House chambers and the Senate chambers, shouting at times in the face of police officers or sergeant in arms who are trying to keep them out of the chambers where they're not allowed. Some of the members would go up into the gallery in the Senate, which again is open to the public. Some of these armed activists, I mean, would go up into that gallery with their long guns, and they were literally standing over lawmakers as they contemplated, again, this outstanding issue of whether to extend emergency authorization for COVID orders. So it was a super tense scene. I mean, some of the senators, you know, on the Democratic side certainly expressed a lot of fear and unease. Senator Sylvia Santana wore a bulletproof vest on the floor of the Senate that day. Senate Majority Mike Shirky, notably, he did say on the record that he thought some of the people there were, I won't swear, but a-holes. So he did, you know, criticize some of those people, but he also went into the gallery and talked to some of the protesters as well. And he later would meet with some of the militia groups, as he put it, to kind of be a peace broker. But to a lot of people, that sort of legitimized those groups at the same time. And he's gotten a lot of criticism for that. It was a really interesting day at the Michigan Capitol. I will say the Michigan Capitol has a history of armed gatherings, typically peaceful once a year. There's a Second Amendment rally at the Michigan Capitol where lots of gun owners bring long guns, typically stand out in the lawn, sometimes do go inside. It's not unheard of. But the difference, obviously, in April 30 was that there was such anger, visceral anger from these people with long guns that really made it seem like a much more menacing gathering than these Second Amendment rallies we've seen often at the Michigan Capitol.
And just to quickly jump in, just to add to that, I mean, a lot of people saw that Michigan storming, especially, but also it wasn't the only one. There was also a similar event that happened in Idaho at the Capitol, and a lot of people saw those as sort of dry runs for January 6th. Perhaps not directly. Not that people are claiming that there was sort of a direct plan that stemmed from the same people by any means, mm-hmm. but it happened in Michigan and there were no consequences. Because as Jonathan said, what they were doing was not illegal. And Idaho has similarly loose gun laws at the Capitol. So when Ammon Bundy said, infamous anti-government activist, when he and his followers stormed the Idaho Capitol, they even actually broke a glass door on their way in, and they were actually breaking COVID rules. They also had no consequences. They basically occupied the gallery, protesting COVID rules, and they weren't thrown out. In fact, the Speaker of the House just kind of continued with business. So, you know, folks that I've talked to who watch extremism and watch sort of the creep of extremism into mainstream politics, they do point to these events as perhaps kind of emboldening people to do something like storm the Capitol, the U.S. Capitol, on January 6th.
Well, thank you. Answer the question I was going to ask about what is happening in Michigan is playing out nationally. So, because that definitely, I think people have been talking a lot about echoes of that event in April 2020, having, like you said, being the precursor to January 6th. I want to unpack a little bit something Jonathan said about the legitimizing or the perception of some of the legitimization of these groups. And, you know, and because it seems like we are seeing between, you know, the elected officials embracing of these groups of, you know, people who were, you know, former protesters or rioters or insurgents, whatever you want to call them, who are now running for office. or you know, becoming very active in party politics. Why and how are these extremist groups becoming more mainstream?
Well, I'll say from my reporting on the ground here in Michigan, I mean, they've made a concerted effort to. I mean, at a Michigan Capitol rally that preceded the April 31, in fact, I spoke to several militia activists, organizers, and, you know, Boogaloo Boys, 3%ers. They were all there publicly and very much telling me, yes, we are trying to mainstream here. We are, you know, real. We've been out there, maybe not in public view any longer, but we're coming out of the shadows now. And they were very clear that was part of their mission, attending these rallies to, you know, put a public face or put a new face, maybe a friendlier public face, they thought, to the movement that they were a part of. And then certainly when you get into, you know, politicians, not necessarily denouncing, but at times not embracing either, but at least interacting. I mean, Mike Shirky, the Senate Majority Leader, he, of course, as I mentioned, met with some militia leaders after the April 30 protest, and he said that he was giving them advice on how to message better, in fact, and how to perhaps appear less threatening. Now, he is a strong, you know, gun rights proponent himself. So, you know, perhaps he was explaining to them maybe how they might, you know, get that message across a little more instead of some of the other things that they're perhaps associated with. But he also, you know, went to a separate rally in Grand Rapids, where he, again, shared the stage with militia members. And in fact, two of those men on stage with him were arrested and prosecuted in a case involving the Whitmer kidnapping plot. They were not federal defendants, but they were state defendants, the Knoll brothers, and they were accused of being part of the nighttime reconnaissance mission to surveil the governor's house vacation home in northern Michigan. They have not yet stood trial. Those cases are still active, so we don't know how they'll resolve. But, you know, you saw the arguably the most powerful Republican in elected office right now in Michigan, at least at a state level office, sharing the stage and then openly giving advice to militia groups on how to improve their appearance publicly. You have, as I mentioned, a gubernatorial candidate, Ryan Kelly, who invited those armed protesters to provide extra, you know, curricular security detail at a Capitol rally. So these groups are trying to mainstream themselves, and at times they're getting some assists from politicians.
What would you say are the factors that are facilitating that? I mean, you said that, you know, they're coming out of the shadows, and it looks like they are coming from the shadows and now center stage, right? And there has to be sort of conditions that make it conducive for them to do that. So what would you say are some of the factors that would cause that are contributing to the embrace that they are seemingly getting, at least in some corners of the party?
Yeah, well, obviously, you know, we live in a supercharged political times where, certain forms of protest or simple commentary have become more acceptable than they would have been in the past. And, you know, not to harp on this repeatedly, but the pandemic, I think, really, you know, gave people a license to you know, show up and act out in ways they would not have necessarily before. It was a rallying point for these organizations, and maybe these, you know, factors were or these conditions were bubbling up for a long time, but you know, they were surrounded by hundreds of other people who were not militia activists, who were also at the Capitol angry and screaming. And they were just, you know, it allowed them to simply be part of a movement, not necessarily just in a militia movement at the Capitol, but as if to say the militia movement is, you know, as they tried to mainstream themselves, just part of a larger, group of activists that were very upset at the time.
And I would also say, I mean, part of the reason that this is happening, Jonathan alluded to this a little bit, but is that the militia movement's just changed a lot. You know, you can look at the old Michigan militia as kind of the founding group of this movement. And in the Extremely American podcast, I actually talked to one of the kind of founding members of the movement. And, you know, he talked about the evolution. You know, back then they were kind of content to train and, you know, have their ideology, but they kind of didn't trust either party, and they kind of just didn't trust electoral politics in general. There's a whole new generation of younger leaders that are not content to train in the woods. They want to affect change, and they want to do it sometimes from the inside. So, you know, there's been a real change in just mentality, where these guys are like, yeah, we're gonna train to fight against what we term a tyrannical government, if that happens, but we're also going to run for office. And that's a sea change. I mean, that's a radically different approach. And they've done it at just the right moment. And Jonathan mentioned this too, and I totally agree. It's you cannot separate the pandemic from that. I mean, that's emboldened them. It's moved, you know, I think we've all had to like look up the Overton window and what that means, the, you know, acceptable political speech. I mean, that line just keeps moving and moving and moving. And I think that's really helped groups like militias be palatable, or at least not rejected outright by mainstream politicians, because politicians, I think, especially in the Republican Party, feel like that's a dangerous thing to do in a primary election, to reject groups like that, because they frankly kind of need votes from the far right.
Are there any fault lines within these groups over the efforts to mainstream? I mean, a militia is sort of, I think, by design, anti-establishment. And so, and one of the most establishment things you could do is run for office. Are you seeing any tensions between some of sort of the older militia members and like you said, the younger folks who are looking to maybe play more of an inside game?
Oh, I mean, in some ways, the militia movement and the broader so-called patriot movement of these far-right groups is nothing but a series of fractures. They disagree on a lot of things. And I think that's a big misunderstanding that a lot of folks have. Sometimes we like to lump all these groups in as sort of a monolith. And there are some principles that they all kind of rally around. Two of them principally are gun rights and sort of a radically limited view of what government should be allowed to do. Other than that, they disagree on a lot of things. And even just here in Idaho, a small state, you see there's folks who, you know, who don't even talk to each other anymore. They're so angry at each other. That idea of mainstreaming or just fighting everything, that is a big fault line. So you see somebody like Ammon Bundy, for example. He wants to fight. He doesn't believe in compromising at all. And he kind of doesn't believe in electoral politics, or at least that's what he said. Now he's running this sort of quixotic campaign for governor, which is sort of a curveball from him. But, you know, the 3% of groups around here who are much more involved in politics and much more willing to reach out to elected officials, they don't always like what Ammon Bundy's doing. Sometimes they think he picks fights that he shouldn't. So I mean, that's just one example. But again, groups that have anti-government views have a hard time coalescing around a sort of common vision.
Yeah, one of the things we saw in the Whitmer kidnapping trial as well, as we got to see a ton of, you know, internal communications from these groups. And in fact, one of the splits between folks who ended up being prosecuted by the federal government and by the state was that some of the folks who ended up being prosecuted by the state were wanting to go to more rallies, be more out in the public, whereas the group that was accused of really, you know, focusing on the kidnapping plot, again, two of them were acquitted, but they, you know, were much more serious about keeping their conversations clandestine, not being seen in public. So there was a clear split between members of that initial group even and how they wanted to be seen publicly or not.
Yeah, got it. Okay, I'm sorry, I just want to keep track of time here. So, okay, a quick bit of historical context to tee up my next question. In 1967, the Black Panthers held an armed protest on the steps of the California State House, a display that frightened lawmakers so much that the legislature passed the Mulford Act, prohibiting the public carrying of loaded firearms without a permit, and that specifically prohibited loaded firearms in the Capitol building. This legislation, which was bipartisan and backed by the NRA, was the first in a wave of laws passed in the late 1960s designed to suppress Black gun ownership. Black people have largely been excluded from Second Amendment debates, and as a nation, we've witnessed shocking incidents of Black people who are legal gun owners, notably Philando Castile in Minnesota, who themselves become victims of gun violence, either by law enforcement or others who perceive them as threats, rather than recognizing their rights as legal gun owners. And yet today, we're talking mostly about white militias, or mostly white militias, freely roaming streets nationwide, showing up to the state capitol with long guns, having firearms on display at protests, going largely unconfronted by law enforcement. So it begs the question, you know, what role does race play in what's playing out both in Michigan and nationally related to extremism, and who has the agency for armed protest and who doesn't?
Yeah, I can start on that. I mean, you brought up a sort of this really famous moment in gun rights in California. And yes, I mean, it's really jarring to see the difference in reaction to the Black Panthers occupying a Capitol as opposed to what happened in Michigan. And I don't think you can, you know, you can look at these movements and their open carrying of firearms and all kinds of tense situations and the law enforcement reaction and not come to the conclusion that, you know, there certainly does seem to be a double standard. And that comes up a lot when I talk to folks who sort of oppose these groups, especially people of color who are opposing these groups, are like, well, I don't think I can go wave a gun around at a tense protest and feel comfortable that I won't be killed, you know, not just arrested, but like worried about getting killed. So, yes, I mean, at the very least, in an indirect way, I think this shines a light on some real double standards. You know, these groups, there are certainly prominent people of color within the Patriot movement. You know, the leader of the Proud Boys is one that I would point to, and there are others, and there's certainly people of color who advocate for gun rights, but by and large, it is a very largely white movement, and whether it's conscious or not, you know, I think these folks feel comfortable coming out and bringing their guns into these often tense protests, partly because they haven't had to deal with the same kind of police reaction that people of color have dealt with. And I think that's something that, you know, a lot of these groups don't want to address that. When I talk about that, they want to say basically they're colorblind and, you know, colorblind society. And to be honest, I think there's a bit of sort of, I would say, convenient suspension of disbelief about the actual, you know, reality going on. Mm-hmm. But yes, at the very least, it shines a light on two different realities.
Yeah, just a couple points. I think just like Heath mentioned, a diversity of opinions within militias that extends to race issues as well. I mean, some groups, you know, openly say they are anti-racist groups. Some obviously harbor white supremacists in their midst. There's a range, but yeah, to the broader point, I mean, certainly at you know, at the Michigan Capitol rallies, the vast majority, overwhelming majority of armed demonstrators have been white people. One state legislator here, State Representative Sarah Anthony, she said, you know, she felt particularly threatened on April 30, 2020, when that mass protest. She's a lawmaker of color. She felt particularly threatened as a sort of demonstration, both for her own, she said, security, but also notably to sort of test this idea of if armed Black men or women would be treated differently. She was escorted into the Capitol a few days later by armed Black men. Now, it went off without incident. It was only three armed men. I think it was not a massive uprising or anything of that nature. And I think, because of the press attention, people knew this was going to happen. So it's not exactly a perfect parallel to test how the reactions may or may not have been similar. But certainly, a lot of people of color brought up that point after the Capitol, that they certainly thought matters might have unfolded much differently had the vast majority of those people not been white.
Great. Thank you both for that. We have a couple of minutes before we're going to open it up to questions from the audience. So I just wanted to have you both weigh in on what the response to political extremism has been, both in Michigan and nationally, from everyday people, but also particularly from policymakers.
Yeah, well, in Michigan, there hasn't been a huge policy response. I mean, the legislature here is controlled by Republicans who, as Heath mentioned, are wary of angering anyone on the gun rights side for fear of losing some of their base support in elections. So we haven't seen, any major reactions on the policy front, aside from the state, the Capitol Commission, which is a bipartisan group of appointees, did end up banning the open carry of guns at the Michigan Capitol. Now, there's a major loophole, which is that concealed carry is still allowed. So you can still bring guns into the Michigan Capitol. You just can't display them anymore. Right. It was a change. It was sort of seen as a half measure to at least appease people who maybe are frightened by the appearance of guns. But it was at least some sort of reaction. But that's been about it on the policy front. I will note that I've been interested in some work by nonprofit groups in this space. There's a group called Parents for Peace that worked with one of the men accused in the Whitmer kidnapping case, actually, to lead him through what was called de-radicalization training. And that young man ended up pleading guilty, and this training that he had gone through, at least led the judge to a little more lenient sentence than he might have otherwise gotten. Of course, now some of his peers were acquitted, so hard to say whether it was the correct approach from him, yeah. for him from a legal perspective. But certainly, he's talked in court and his family too about how important that sort of essentially therapy was for him. Mm-hmm.
What I have seen on the non-policy side is, and I get into this in the podcast too, and shine a light on some of these groups, is there are groups that have been popping up in sort of an ad hoc way, not really organized, but kind of anti-extremist groups. And it dovetails with politics because they advocate for the candidates they see as non-extremists, but these groups have popped up sort of in opposition to groups like the 3% Militia, the Oath Keepers. Just in Idaho alone, we actually just had our third sort of anti-extremist group pop up just the other day. So it's a crowded space here. How effective they are, I think that's still to be seen. And I think these primary elections coming up, which in a lot of places are coming up this month, is probably going to say a lot about efforts to combat extremism in politics, at least.
Yes, and I just want to get in a quick plug for Heath's podcast, Extremely American. It is as terrifying as it is terrific in hearing these stories. And he does a really good job in sort of capturing the conversations that are taking place, and particularly the episode where folks are working to counteract some of these activities is particularly interesting. Okay, we're going to now open it up for questions from the audience. A reminder that you can submit your questions in the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen. Okay, first question. We hear that Michigan has a long history of militias and white supremacist movements. Can anyone say a few words about that? What makes Michigan specifically such a hotbed? How did this start? Why Michigan?
Yeah, I can speak to that a little bit. I mean, experts I've talked to, you know, suggest one of the reasons is simply Michigan is such a large state. There are lots of very rural areas where, you know, gun culture is very much the norm. For instance, when I was up in Bad Axe reporting on this white supremacist group called The Base, as I mentioned, a lot of community members didn't really bat an eye when they saw these kids maybe running around in the woods with guns, because that wasn't all that unusual or unacceptable. So, you know, just these wide open spaces is both, you know, sort of, allows this activity to go maybe without as much scrutiny, but also is attractive to people as well. Those same members talked about buying land in the Upper Peninsula to create sort of a white compound up there to prepare for what they thought were impending race wars. At the same time, you know, I know there's a lot of places in the United States that have lots of rural area and maybe don't have the same militia movements here. I mean, part of it is magnanimous leaders, you know, Norm Olson, who helped found the Michigan militia here. He was a very public and outspoken guy. And, you know, like Amon Bundy in Idaho, I mean, if you have a magnanimous figure, people tend to rally around them. And that certainly happened here decades ago, laying the groundwork for what is a sustained militia movement in the state.
Keith, did you have anything you wanted to add to that?
I agree. I don't discount the availability of sort of, you know, empty space. You see the same thing in Idaho, Montana, parts of Washington and Oregon. Being able to kind of hide out in the woods is very attractive. You know, I think what's interesting about Michigan too, though, is Michigan has this sort of extreme rural-urban divide and a real political divide, I think, that really also drives that. It was interesting to me talking to some of the old school Michigan militia members. A lot of them were from Detroit, which sort of surprised me. I was like, oh, okay, well, that's interesting. And, you know, this gets back into your question about race. Did that come up specifically? No. Was there some coded language in some of the things I heard from, you know, white guys in Detroit about problems in the city and stuff? I think a lot of people would come to that conclusion. So I think that divide in Michigan, be it political, urban, rural, some racial divide there, I think that also helps drive extremist movements like this.
Okay, another question. I thought armed militia groups were illegal if the group is not organized or sanctioned by the state government. Please comment.
I'll jump in here just because I did a whole episode on this former federal prosecutor who would say that you were exactly right and is trying to get states to enforce their laws. So every state in the union and DC has laws on their books. They're all slightly different because we have this decentralized, decentralized justice system in the US. So every state's a little bit different, but basically every state has a law that says you can't impersonate the military. You can't impersonate law enforcement. You can't be a private group that assumes the duties of either one. So what Mary McCord, this former federal prosecutor who's now at Georgetown Law, says is that, well, that means that a lot of militias are operating illegally because they are doing things that are too similar to actual militaries and they're training for a potential conflict with the government. Now, obviously, these militia groups would very much disagree. But she's had some early success in court. So she's pursuing it civilly, not legally. She's not looking to put people in jail at the moment. But she got a settlement in Charlottesville, where we had that deadly clash, where a bunch of white supremacist groups as well as some militia groups gathered. She beat them in court. They settled and basically agreed never to come back to Charlottesville as a group. She's also suing a militia right now in New Mexico. And she's cleared a couple early hurdles, but we'll see how that goes. So it's a long way of saying, some people would say, yeah, that a lot of the things they do are illegal, but it hasn't really been tested in court to the degree where you could say there's a precedent yet. That's still kind of the Wild West.
A quick follow-up from me. In hearing you talk, I was reminded of the tee up of the episode of your podcast that focused on Michigan that talked about both the incidents in Ruby Ridge and Waco and the botched federal response. Did that have a chilling effect in terms of like the government's willingness to try to curtail these groups?
Oh yeah, yes. I think the government has gotten more and more nervous about pursuing these groups over the years. That I think had a big effect. I think they've had quite a few failures in court. And I think that's made them a lot more shy about going after these groups. So that definitely had an effect. And then when 9/11 happened and the whole sort of federal apparatus switched to looking at foreign terrorism, that had an even bigger effect on the government sort of not really paying attention to domestic extremism. And that's gone on for years. I'd say it's only really changing now. Even under the Obama administration, which you think might have looked more closely at it, to be honest, they didn't really. And to the point where one of the guys I interviewed for the podcast, who's this former Homeland Security official, got chased out of office for basically saying, hey, this is a big threat, we should look at it. And he did that 10 years ago and really sort of prophesized a lot of things and was rewarded by basically losing his job. So yes, the government's taken their eye off the ball for a long time and is only now sort of starting to get that back.
Another follow-up, this time from the audience, and I'm gonna direct this to Jonathan because I want to talk about the outcome of the trial on the kidnapping plot for Governor Whitmer. The question is, why are these actors so hard to convict at trial?
Well, that's a really good question. I mean, in a lot of cases, you know, both in the Hutari case in Michigan several years ago, and now the Wolverine Watchman case, you open up all these questions of what is free speech? How far does that free speech, protection go? And when does that speech become something more sinister, an actual conspiracy, an actual plot to kidnap the governor in this case? That was at issue in both of those cases. I mean, there were certainly, some missteps by the FBI and the federal prosecutors. I mean, some of the at least two of the key FBI agents who were involved in this case were not able to testify at trial. One of them because he was convicted separately of abusing his wife. And there were, just other questions over the use of informants. Obviously, the entrapment defense. The defense attorneys barely even raised it. They didn't have to. They just, noted repeatedly how many informants were involved and at least a couple undercover agents as well to raise doubts, raise suspicions. I mean, so there were missteps certainly, but also just that underlying difficulty of arguing, when free speech crosses the line. It's a hard line to prove without the use of these informants, but then those informants seemingly undermine the case as well.
Would we be wrong to read into it as well? Maybe the changing perceptions that come with the mainstreaming of these groups, that maybe people just are more accepting, and that may have had an impact on the outcome of this case?
Certainly possible. You know, I haven't had the opportunity to talk to any of the jurors who actually sat in on the case and decided it. But, you know, what they ultimately decided was that, I mean, they were presented with lots of evidence, like recordings, right, of conversations these people had, these men had. And the conclusion they came to was that didn't amount to an actual conspiracy, like concrete plans to actually move forward, or an agreement to move forward. So, you know, certainly in this charged political environment, there's a possibility that, you know, folks who saw, for instance, the April 30 protest on television said, well, a lot of people were angry and saying inappropriate, potentially, things about the governor at that time. That in and of itself is not criminal.
Pulling up another question here from the audience. Could you address the role that social media platforms played in unifying and organizing militia groups and extremists?
So I would say they played a huge role. You know, I'd argue the two biggest groups, the militia groups in the country now, are the Oath Keepers and the Three Percenters, which are more sort of ideologies rather than groups because they're so decentralized. But, you know, back in the old Michigan militia days, you didn't have any national militia movement because it was just, communication was just a lot harder. So yes, and I think it's an interesting question because I would say that it absolutely helped these groups recruit, it helped grow, it helped create these national movements. And then when a lot of them started getting deplatformed, it really hurt them. And leaders I've talked to have been sort of surprisingly open about how much it hurt them. They said when Facebook started cracking down that it really became hard to reach out to members, and especially to get new members. And an interesting thing that they said, which I've also heard from researchers who follow these groups, is that it potentially radicalized people, because the double-edged sword of deplatforming is, sure, you're going to hurt the recruiting, but you also kind of send them down into echo chambers, into alternative social media like Telegram, and even some dark web stuff, where they're not getting that sort of outside influence as well, the more mainstream stuff. They're just hearing people who are on board with some, you know, pretty far right and pretty radical stuff. And there is a little bit of a worry that a knock-on effect of deplatforming could be that the more extreme elements become even more extreme, and that could blow up into violence.
Yeah, and another byproduct of the Facebook purge, from researchers I've talked to who have spent years researching militia movements, is that it also makes it harder to track the groups if they're not on Facebook, because some of them were quite public on that platform and now have gone to other channels that are maybe not public, or, you know, just simply harder to find. So, you know, Facebook, for all its warts, did give people kind of a unique glimpse into some of these groups and their organizing activities, while also enabling those activities to occur.
Okay, another audience question. Can you project a little bit to the election context? Do you see folks going to the polls, patrolling the polls, in a matter of speaking? What type of activity do you hear or see as it pertains to elections, if any? And if so, what has been the impact of this activity?
Yeah, so there was a big debate in Michigan in 2020 when Secretary of State Jocelyn Benson issued an essentially an order to ban guns at polling places. Ultimately, that attempt was thwarted because she didn't have the power to do so, according to courts. But she was certainly concerned. We did not end up seeing a huge number of armed poll challengers show up. Certainly, we saw a lot of challengers, particularly on the GOP side, flood the TCF Center in Detroit, for instance, as absentee ballots were being counted there. But it's still a concern for election officials because, for instance, a state Senate candidate here, Mike Detmer, has said openly encouraged people to show up at the polls armed. He believes the 2020 election was stolen, and he says, we have to make sure it doesn't happen again. I don't know. He didn't say what he wants people to do with their guns once they show up at the polls, but he encouraged them to do so. So obviously, poll challengers are entirely legal, allowed, but there's an open question of when, if they're carrying a gun, does that then become a form of intimidation for voters at the polls? And that's what Secretary of State Jocelyn Benson said she was trying to deter at the time when she issued that rule that ultimately was not enforceable.
I would just say from a more national perspective, there was a huge worry last election, whether or not it was sort of the outcry before and a lot of attorneys general coming out and saying this will not be tolerated, intimidation will not be tolerated, or whether it just wasn't going to happen in the first place. I will say we didn't see a lot of that at all. I think in the run up to the midterms, I've actually heard a lot less about that, a lot more worry about sort of more organized voter suppression from a policy perspective than folks showing up to the polls armed. But I don't think that's, I don't think that fear has gone away completely. And as Jonathan mentioned, I think some of the, depending on what state you're in, some of the legal ramifications can be a little muddy.
Great. Well, with that, I want to close out the terrific conversation. Give you guys an opportunity, if you have any final words that you want to leave our audience with. This has been a really great conversation. So glad that you guys were able to join us today.
Yeah,
any final words? Hopefully hopeful. A hopeful, upbeat note.
Yeah, check out Heath's podcast I did recently, and especially the Michigan episode I found very interesting. Good work.
Thank you very much. The only thing I would say is one thing we didn't get into is that, a lot of these groups are into local politics and a lot of elections that we sort of ignore. And I think one of the takeaways from my reporting is that whatever your views, we should all be a little more involved in our local elections and pay a lot more attention. Who's on your school board? Do you know? I didn't know before the podcast. So yes, be involved, vote.
Absolutely. Well, thank you guys for joining us today. And thank you in the audience for joining us as well. Again, a reminder that today's webinar was recorded and in the coming days will be made available on the Joyce Foundation and Bridge Michigan websites. In addition, we will be sure to share any key materials referenced in today's webinar. And finally, a quick note about the next Lunch and Learn webinar we will be hosting. On Wednesday, May 25th, from noon to 1 p.m. Central, the Joyce Foundation will resume the discussion of perceived versus actual risk of firearm ownership when we host a discussion with Dr. David Studdard from Stanford University and Dr. Matt Miller from Northeastern University, who will discuss their research on secondhand risks of firearm ownership. A link to register for this webinar will be circulated by email and on social media channels after today's discussion. Thank you again to our speakers and to all of you for joining us today. Have a great rest of your day.